So Finney should be here, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll just think of words.
Yeah, appreciate it.
Page 119 of your prayer book. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
O God, whose Son has taught us that love is the fulfillment of your law, stir up within us the fire of your Holy Spirit and pour into our hearts your greatest gift of love, so that we may love you with our whole being and our neighbors as ourselves. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading.
A reading from Deuteronomy chapter 34, verses 1 to 12. Then Moses went up from the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo, to the top of Pisgah, which is opposite Jericho. And the Lord showed him the whole land, Gilead as far as Dan, all Naphtali, the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, all the land of Judah as far as the western sea, the Negeb and the plain, that is, the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees, as far as Zoar. The Lord said to him, this is the land of which I swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you shall not cross over there. Then Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, at the Lord's command. He was buried in a valley in the land of Moab, opposite Beth-Peor. But no one knows his burial place to this day. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His sight was unimpaired, and his vigor had not abated. The Israelites wept for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days. Then the period of mourning for Moses was ended. Joshua, son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid his hands on him, and the Israelites obeyed him, doing as the Lord had commanded Moses. Never since has there been a prophet in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. He was unequaled for all the signs and wonders that the Lord sent him to perform in the land of Egypt, against Pharaoh and all his servants and his entire land, and for all the mighty deeds and all the terrifying displays of power that Moses performed in the sight of all Israel. Hear the word of the Lord.
The choir will lead us in Psalm 90, which is in the center of your pew sheet.
Thank you. Today's New Testament reading comes from Paul's letter, the first letter to the Thessalonians, chapter 2, beginning at the first verse. You yourselves know, brothers and sisters, that our coming to you was not in vain, but though we had already suffered and been shamefully maltreated at Philippi, as you know, we had courage in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in spite of great opposition. For our appeal does not spring from deceit or impure motives or trickery, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the message of the gospel, even so we speak not to please mortals, but to please God who tests our hearts. As you know, and as God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery or with pretext for greed, nor did we seek praise from mortals, whether from you or from others, though we might have made demands as apostles of Christ, but we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for their own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you have become very dear to us. You remember our labor and toil, brothers and sisters. We worked night and day so that we might not burden any of you while we proclaim to you the gospel of God. You are witnesses, and God also, how pure, upright, and blameless our conduct was towards you believers. As you know, we dealt with each one of you, like a father with his children, urging and encouraging you and pleading that you should lead a life worthy of God, who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. We are constantly giving thanks to God for this, that when you received the word of God that you heard from us, you accepted it not as a human word, but as what it really is, God's word, which is also at work in you believers. Hear the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Reading. The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew, chapter 22, beginning at the 34th verse.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
When the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest? He said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Now, while the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them this question. What do you think of the Messiah? Whose son is he? They said to him, the son of David. He said to them, how is it then that David, by the Spirit, calls him Lord, saying, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand, until I put your enemies under your feet. If David thus calls him Lord, how can he be his son? No one was able to give him an answer, nor from that day did anyone dare to ask him any more questions. For the gospel of the Lord, praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. May my words be filled with the wisdom of God, the love of Jesus, and the joy of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. We have a picture book at home called God's Dream by Archbishop Desmond Tutu. The book asks, Dear child of God, do you know what God dreams about? As I think about it, I wonder if that is another way of asking, which commandment in the law is the greatest? Which commandment shows what God's priorities are? What is God's dream? The gospel story today opens with a gathering of the Pharisees. This encounter takes place during Holy Week. Matthew chapter 21 contains Jesus' triumphal entry to Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, the cleansing of the temple, followed by a series of parables. Halfway through chapter 22, the Pharisees escalate their attempt to trap Jesus and silence him. They ask a question about taxes. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor? Jesus rebuts them. Next, the Sadducees ask a question about levirate marriage and resurrection. If the same woman marries seven brothers under levirate law, whose wife will she be at the resurrection? Then the Pharisees gather together again. After Jesus has defeated two challenges on particular points of law, this time they seem to go for a more general approach. Which commandment in the law is the greatest? I wonder, was this part of a legal strategy? Were they trying to outwit Jesus with an unanswerable question? Were they trying to get an edge by having him pick the commandment to be debated? Or was the spokesperson, whether on his own behalf or the group's, genuinely seeking to discern what the law requires of him? Patrick Gray argues that a more accurate translation or rendering of the lawyer's question could be, what sort of commandment is most important? He points to the fact that rabbinic commentary is replete with discussion of the relative importance of the light and heavy commandments among those given in Torah, of which there are 613 according to Jewish tradition, 248 positive injunctions, and 365 prohibitions. I know for sure that in the Christian church today, even in the Anglican Church of Australia, theologians get caught in endless debates over which commandments might be more important than others. And we have Gospel and New Testament commandments on top of the 618 in Torah. Maybe it would be nice to have someone come and put them in an indisputable order of importance. But in quoting the Shema, Jesus points out that the aim of the law is to orient one's entire life towards God. So what does it mean to love God wholeheartedly, with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind? In the Old Testament reading today, we heard about the death of Moses, and what a eulogy. Never since has there arisen a prophet in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. He was unequaled for all the signs and wonders that the Lord sent him to perform in the land of Egypt, against Pharaoh and all his servants and his entire land, and for all the mighty deeds and all the terrifying displays of power that Moses performed in the sight of all Israel. When I think of Moses as the one whom the Lord knew face to face, I always think of the passage in Exodus, which describes Moses speaking with God. when Moses goes up the mountain or enters the tent, that is, he enters into God's presence, and they meet face to face. But when Moses returns to the people, he has to go veiled. The people are scared because the light of God's grace shines so brightly from his face. Is this what it means to love God wholeheartedly? To spend so much time deeply in God's presence that other people literally see the light of God in your face? Ignatian author James Skian writes about longing to be seized so completely by the love of God that all the desires of my heart and all the actions, affections, thoughts, and decisions which flow from them are directed to God. Is loving God wholeheartedly about letting go of self-interest, of privilege, even of self-control? To love God is to love in the way God loves, indiscriminately. To love God is to love what God loves, everything. Yes, even our enemies, even those who disgust us, those who are different from us, even those who are merely annoying. Because God is the source of all being, and God loves all God's creatures. Too often we think of love as a feeling, a spontaneous and free-flowing feeling that arises out of our own enjoyment, our own sense of kinship and affinity. We don't think of it as a discipline, as practice, as exercise, as effort. We talk and think about love as if we have little power or agency in its presence. Incidentally, I have a book of poems at home called Poems by the Heart, and it's a book of love poetry. But what I appreciate most is that it has a dozen sections on different kinds of love, from the first blush of new love, unrequited love, missed love. And it's just nice to see for once how comprehensive, how all-consuming love can be in all its different ways. In the Bible, Jesus doesn't say, "I sure hope love happens to you." He says, "Love is the greatest and first commandment," meaning it's not a matter of personal affinity, feeling, or preference. It's not a matter of lucky accident. It's a matter of obedience to the one we call Lord. Which returns us to the question of law and commandment. The law and commandments in Scripture are a human attempt to define a God-oriented life. Obedience to the laws is seen as obedience to God. They are a way for us to love with discipline, practice, exercise, and effort, especially when the feeling of love may escape us. And at the same time, Jesus reminds us and his listeners that a God-oriented life is about more than following a checklist of injunctions and prohibitions. The motion of our hearts must be cyclical. Love of God making possible and deepening our love of neighbor, and love of neighbor putting flesh and bones on our love of God. Dear child of God, do you know what God dreams about? God dreams about people sharing. God dreams about people caring. God dreams that we reach out and hold one another's hands and play one another's games and laugh with one another's hearts. Each of us carries a piece of God's heart within us. And when we love one another, the pieces of God's heart are made whole. Will you help God's dream come true?
page 123 of the prayer book. Let us together stand and affirm the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the world and for the Church. The response to the bidding, Lord, hear us, is, Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear us. Lord, hear our prayer. Jesus' disciples asked him to teach them to pray, and he gave them the prayer that said millions of times a day throughout the world. But there's a difference between saying the prayer and praying it. So let us pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you, Father, for letting us get this close, for letting us call you Abba, Dad. We're thrilled to be part of the family, with Jesus as our older brother. Make us more like him. Lord, hear us. Lord, hear our prayer. Hallowed be your name. Make your name be holy in a world that recognizes holiness in all the wrong things, worshipping money, celebrity, and power. Instead, may our vision be filled with the holiness of your beauty, tenderness, and love. Lord, hear us. Lord, hear our prayer. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. This is the most exciting prayer we could ever make, that your alternative way of living should be established here among us, on earth, starting here and now. Help us, your Church, to be the testbed of the kingdom, where we try out your commands and promises and find them to be true. Lord, hear us. Lord, hear our prayer. Give us today our daily bread, so that everyone on earth has what they need to flourish and to enjoy life in abundance. We bring to your table the world's hungry outsiders and pray that finally and together we might come to the festal banquet where the last will be first, and no one is forgotten. Lord, hear us. Lord, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Help us to recognize our sin as addiction to ourselves, often at the expense of others. Then, Father, forgive not with an easy tolerance of our age, but with a rich, hard, shocking, life-changing forgiveness that we see coming from the cross. And give us grace to pass that forgiveness on to others. Lord, hear us. Lord, hear our prayer. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Not just the little stuff, the failings and foibles to which we are all prone, but the heavy duty, deep darkness that opposes your reign of justice and love all over the world. Help us to resist the massive attack of evil wherever we see it, including in ourselves, and to push back confidently in the name of Christ. Lord, hear us. Lord, hear our prayer. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Thank you for the outcome, for that outcome, that the outcome of the struggle isn't in doubt. We can raise our eyes to the coming dawn because nothing can ultimately hold back your reign of love. In the resurrection, nothing is left unchanged. Alleluia, alleluia, amen, amen. Gracious God, accept our prayers through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Page 125, let us pray. We do not presume to come to your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy, welcoming sinners and inviting them to the Lord's table. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, confident in God's forgiveness. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins. Strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand. We are the body of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Please share that peace from your places. him is a new commandment, number 699. On page 130, lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to praise you, faithful God, always and everywhere. For with your only begotten Son and life-giving Spirit, you are the one true God from everlasting to everlasting. At the dawn of time, you wrought from nothing a universe of beauty and splendor, bringing light from darkness and order from chaos. You formed us male and female in your image and endowed us with creative power. We turned away from you, but you did not abandon us. You called us by name and searched us out, making a covenant of mercy, giving the law, and teaching justice by the prophets. And so we praise you, joining with your faithful people of every time and place, singing the eternal song. When the fullness of time was come, you sent your Son to be born of Mary. Bright image of your glory, he learnt obedience to you in all things, even to death on a cross, breaking the power of evil, freeing us from sin, and putting death to flight. You raised him from death, exalting him to glory, and the new day dawned. On the night he was betrayed, your Son, Jesus Christ, shared food with his friends, his companions on the way. While at table he took bread, blessed it and broke it, and giving it to them, he said, "Take, eat, this is my body." He took a cup of wine, and giving thanks, he gave it to them and said, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, living God, as we obey his command, we remember his life of obedience to you, his suffering and death, his resurrection and exaltation, and his promise to be with us forever. With this bread and this cup, we celebrate his saving death until he comes. Accept, we pray, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, and send your Holy Spirit upon us and our celebration, that all who eat and drink at this table may be strengthened by Christ's body and blood to serve you in the world. As one body and one holy people, may we proclaim the everlasting gospel of Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom, with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, eternal God, now and forever. Break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body, for we all share in the one bread. The gifts of God for the people of God. Come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ in remembrance that he died for us and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Living God, in this holy meal you fill us with new hope. May the power of your love, which we have known in word and sacrament, continue your saving work among us. Give us courage for our pilgrimage and bring us to the joys you promise. Most loving God, you send us into the world you love. Give us grace to go thankfully and with courage in the power of your Spirit. The final hymn is number 640, Kneels at the Feet of His Friends. Forgot the blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Thank you.
that self-test finish.